Welcome again to Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown. What is a great short story and what does it take to write one? The Paris Review posed those questions to 20 contemporary authors and asked them to pick a story they loved from the almost 60-year-old archives of the Review. The result is a new collection titled Object Lessons, The Art of the Short Story. And Lorin Stein is the editor of the Paris Review, is here with me to talk about it. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
I was intrigued by a line in your short introduction to the collection. It said, most of all, this is intended for readers who are not or are no longer in the habit of reading short stories. Is there a sense of a lost art? Is that some, or a lost readership?
Well, do you find that you pick up short stories these days in your free time? I tend not to. Maybe you do.
Yeah. Well, I'm more of a novel reader myself.
I think that that's typical for fiction readers. Yeah. And until I took the job at the Paris Review, I'd fallen out of the habit of reading short stories. And then as I went back to them for work, I found that I loved doing it. And I wondered why I'd been away from it for so long.
And?
I still wonder a little bit.
I mean, why is the culture away from it, not just
I'll
you
tell
or
you.
Me?
I think it's a funny counterintuitive fact, I think, that fiction has become more and more of an escape from distraction for us. So it's sort of, we use it in a way that we didn't used to use it, to drop out of the life of distractions that we have. And short stories aren't really made for that. They don't really let you drop out for that long.
Not long enough.
Not long enough.
Now, the idea of going to contemporary writers for this collection, that opens up a discussion of mechanics, right? It opens up a question of, sort of what makes a great short story. Tell me how you went about that, picking the writers, and what were you after there?
Well, they were writers who my colleague Sadie Stein and I admired for different reasons, but they were also very different from each other. So we wanted to get a mix of different voices, all people whose opinions we respect, but we knew we would get very different choices from them. Mm-hmm. And they didn't let us down.
Well, I knew just a few of the stories myself, maybe three of them. And I've enjoyed getting to read more. But what about you? Did you know?
I'm in exactly your position.
Really?
And so is Sadie. Well, the Paris Review has been around long enough that no one alive, George Plimpton, the founding editor, died 6 years ago.
Right.
There's no one alive now who knows the whole archive. It's not digitized. But even if it were, it would take years to read through it. So we asked these people to lead us back into our own archive and show us what their favorites were. And often they would get back to us within minutes and say, I've been thinking about this story for years or decades. And some of them, of course, we knew, the Borges story, the Raymond Carver story.
Those were two of the three I knew.
What was the third one?
The third one was Dennis Johnston, hitchhiker.
Yes. Yeah. Those were my favorites, too, when we started. But then it was so much fun to see what people came up with that I didn't know.
Well, give me an example of some either connection between a contemporary writer and a older story or I don't know, some insight that surprised you.
Well, it was a lot of fun seeing Mona Simpson, who is a writer and used to be an editor of the Paris Review, talking about when Norman Rush's story came into the Review and how her colleague read the first sentence and said, we're going to publish this after reading one sentence. It's something editors don't usually admit, but you can tell in one sentence.
That really?
Was fun. Yes, you can. You usually can. Not always, but usually. A story is short enough that if you don't make a mistake in the first sentence, you probably won't make
There's
a mistake
hope for
all
the rest of it?
Through.
Well, I mean, that leads to my, you know, widening this out to your position now. I assume that one of your roles is to, foster, certainly to publish new short stories,
That's
right?
my main job.
That is your job. That's how you see it. So,
sure.
So how do you do that? How do you go about it?
Well, you read the first sentence. You read lots of first sentences.
Really?
Yeah. We get thousands and thousands of stories every month.
Yeah.
And it's a lot of fun. I've been pleasantly surprised by the sophistication of so many young writers. And we're publishing a lot of people I'd never heard of before. A lot of beginners.
Really?
Yeah.
But to go back to this novel versus short story, I mean, do you sense any, I mean, is renaissance too big a word? But, I mean, do you sense a more turning to it or a more interest in it? On the part of writers, I mean.
I understand. I think writers are coming to it from fresh paths. It used to be that you would go into a writing program and what you would learn was how to write a short story.
Mm-hmm.
You'd pick up the magazines and you would be taught from the magazines how to write a short story.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, student writers are learning to write novels because that market has gone. Mm-hmm. So the ones who are drawn to the form are doing it really for reasons of their own, and that's mm-hmm. really exciting. And, you know, every year we give a prize, a $10,000 prize, to the best emerging writer we publish, whose fiction we publish in the review. And they've gotten weirder and weirder, and to me, more and more interesting as time goes by. So,
let me just ask you one final thing about the Paris Review itself. Mm-hmm. As you said, George Plimpton, of course, people will know as the founding and longtime editor. You're just the third editor.
That's right.
The world has changed since George Plimpton was the editor, right? The world of media, books, magazines. How does the Paris Review change? I've seen some of the ways you've changed with the website, especially. Yeah. But how do you think of it now as a...
Well, I think I understand your question. And we launched an app last month, and we sell all of our subscriptions now pretty much through our website. Mm. But we're really doing these things because we think that the original mission of the Review from 60 years ago, to foster new fiction and poetry and essays at a moment when, as then, they're out of favor with critics, and there's a sense of decline. That was true in 1953. It's even truer now. Mm-hmm. We're just doing these things so we can keep doing what we do best, in changing everything so that we don't have to change.
All right. This new collection is Object Lessons, The Art of the Short Story. Lorin Stein, thanks so much.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us again on Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown.